Beloved, I'm Pastor Afenumo Shesan, the host of Living by Grace. I believe one of the greatest gifts that the Lord has given unto us as Christians is the gift of grace. For with the grace of God, we can live the life that God gave us in Christ Jesus. Believe me, be child of God, the life that we are given by God in Christ Jesus is a good life. For it is the life of God. It's powerful. It's beautiful, it's successful, it's glorious. According to Isaiah chapter 61, it talks about it as a life that is glorious, a life whose brightness will attract nations and their king. But we need the grace of God to be able to live that life. And that's why I'm excited that you are joining me and several other members of the family of grace all over the world for today's broadcast. I assure you by the grace of God, that through today's broadcast, you will connect with grace that will enable you to live your good life in Christ Jesus. Amen. Welcome back. Today we shall be looking at Genesis chapter 6, verse 8. But before we go into our study, I'd like us to pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, we thank you. For you have faithfully been blessing us through this platform with grace. And it has enabled us to live our life to the fullest. We thank you for the grace we are going to bless us with today. Thank you, Daddy. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Genesis chapter 6. Verse 8. Genesis chapter 6, verse 8. I read the Message version. But before I read the Message version, let me quote the King James version. The King James version said, "And Noah found grace in the sight of God." But Noah found grace in the sight of God. But the Message version is rendered this way. But Noah was different. God liked what he saw in Noah. Genesis chapter 6 verse 8, the Message version. But Noah was different. God liked what he saw in Noah. Think about that for a moment. But Noah was different. God liked what he saw in Noah. Let us pray. Father, we thank you because today we shall be blessed beyond measures. In Jesus' name I pray. The topic of today's discussion is Dare to be different. The question that I asked myself when the Lord led me to this verse of the Bible was, what was it that God saw in Noah that he liked? Because I believe it is that thing that the Bible was referring to as what made Noah to be different. He said, but Noah was different. God liked what he saw in him. I would like God to be pleased with me. I would like God to see in my life something that he likes. Because I believe that if the Lord should find something in me that he likes, the consequences of that is going to be enormous blessings. So I want to know, Lord, what is it that you found in Noah that you liked? And I'm sure you will be interested in that too. To answer that question, we need to go back to verse 1 and read it all the way down to that verse 8. And you will see that the verse 1 of Genesis chapter 6 started by saying, men began to multiply, having children. And then they began to have daughters. And then the Bible said, certain beings that are referred to as sons of God, they looked down and they saw that the daughters of men were beautiful. And so they came and they began to take the daughters of these men as wife. Now, the implication of that is that for them to be able to take these ladies as wife, the parents of these ladies must have consented to their offers. And then the next thing the Bible said was that the Lord said, my spirit will no longer strive with man, for he is after all flesh. Now, the word strive there, one version says, means abide, meaning, for my spirit will no longer abide with man, for he is also flesh. Then the Bible talked about the kind of children the daughters of men were producing for this strange being. The Bible referred to them as giants and mighty men. Then the Bible began to talk about the characteristics of life on earth in those days. The Bible says evil began to multiply. The thoughts of men, the imagination of men were continually evil, so much that the Bible said God regretted that he had made man. And then God took a decision that he was going to wipe away all of mankind because of the evil they have brought upon the earth. It is in this context that we go to verse 8. And the verse 8 started with the word, but. But Noah was different. Against this background, the Bible said Noah was different. Different from every other man at his time. So you see, the way I see it is this. The time that Noah lived in was a time of widespread of compromise and multiplication of evil. That was the time that Noah lived in. A time when people were walking and dining with the devil. A time when people were selling their souls and their conscience to the devil. For what? Probably for money, for material things, for visibility, social visibility, probably for abominable pleasures, abominable sexual pleasures. Probably for evil, diabolical powers. This was a time when people were selling their souls to the devil, walking and dining with the devil for fame, for positions, political positions, economic strength and positions. At such a time, the Bible said Noah chose to be different. And God took note of that. So, why is everybody around him was using the prevailing realities of that time as an excuse to join the bandwagon and be walking and dining with the devil, walking in the ways of the devil? Noah chose instead to walk and dine with God. That was how Noah differentiated himself from the people of his generation. Noah dared to be different. And I want to believe you can relate to that. Think back. Maybe when you were growing up, maybe your primary school or your secondary school or even your higher education, Or maybe in your present place of work, think back and see whether you can remember a situation that you dared to visibly take a stand that is different from the popular stand. Can you remember any time like that in your life? When you dared to be different. When you dared to stand up for something that every other person stood against. You dare to go a different path from everybody. Can you remember such a time in your life? Probably. And you will agree with me that it was not an easy decision. Neither were the physical consequences of it palatable. If you remember that time that you dared to stand up and be different, you probably were laughed at. You probably were mocked. You probably were ostracized for a season. But if you remember, the fact that you took that decision, there was this joy that you had, knowing that you were standing up for what you are, and you were standing up for what you believe to be who you are, even though you suffered for it, outwardly for a season. Listen to me, child of God. In these times that we live in, which is very similar to the time of Noah, a time when people around us, our political leaders, are not left out. Even our spiritual leaders are not left out. For some of us, even our own parents are not left out. For some of us, even our own spouse and our children are not left out of following the evil trend of this generation. Following the footsteps of people that are selling their souls and selling their conscience to the devil just to be able to dine with him and enjoy the evil pleasures, the evil fame that the devil is offering. Things that are transient and are not lasting. Things that are injurious to the spirit and can doom a man's eternal destiny. At such a time as this, you will agree with me, to decide to be godly, to decide to be upright, at a time when immorality, fornication and adultery is almost becoming approved and accepted, to dare to not sleep with the person you are dating, to dare to not help yourself to money that is meant for others, to dare to be truthful, has very uncomfortable consequences. Not only will you be looked down upon, you may not be able to afford, in quotes, the high standard of living that they are branding all over town, a symbol of having succeeded or having arrived. But you see, the Bible said God liked what he saw. The people will not like it, and that's why they will persecute you. But you see, what is a man compared to God? Nothing. The accolade of men, the praises of men, cannot be compared to that of God. And that's why I'm talking to you. Dare to be different. Why should you dare to be different? For two reasons. One, because you are different. You are not everybody. Permit me to let you know, child of God, that by the reason of your belief in Christ, the Spirit of God, the Almighty God Himself, is inside of you. So you see, you are not like every other person. You have become the dwelling place of God. You have become the tabernacle of God. God lives in you, child of God. So you are different. You cannot condescend to the low level and the low life that these people are living, thinking they are enjoying. Because what you carry, who you carry, is different from who and what they are carrying. They are carrying the spirit of the world, the spirit of the devil. But you are carrying the spirit of God. So because of who you are in Christ, the custodian of God's life, you are different from them. So they are to be different. So if they say they want to follow the pleasures of the flesh, if they say they want to go after carnality and worldliness, they can go. Because they don't have what you have. They don't have who you have. Child of God, the reason why you are called the child of God is because God is in you. So you dare to be different because you are different. The second reason why you should dare to be different is because God trusts you. For God to have saved your soul in the midst of several billions that are yet to come into salvation, God chose you is because God trusted you. He trusts you that you will allow him to have his way through you. That's the second reason, because God trusts you. You know, the Bible said of Job that God told the devil that he trust Job, that Job will not do evil. And Job did not let God down. See, brother, will you let God down? Are you letting God down? Do you know God trusts you? That the reason why God saved your soul, which is the reason why his spirit is in you, is because God trusts you. He puts trust in you that you will allow him to live in you and live through you. The third reason why you should dare to be different is because, according to this scripture we just read, there will always be a consequence. There will definitely come a day when the judgment of God for ungodliness will be visited upon the ungodly. And believe me, child of God, you don't want to experience the judgment of God. It is better for a man to experience the blessings of God than the judgment of God. I'd like you to remember Sodom and Gomorrah as an example of how devastating the judgment of God can be. I'd like you to remember what happened to Herod, the king, when he was appropriating to himself the glory and the honor that is due to God. The Bible said the judgment of God came upon Herod and maggots ate him alive to death. The third reason why you should dare to be different at a time like this, in this country and in your space, when evil is multiplying and people are using the prevalence of ungodliness as a justification to do ungodliness, is because there is going to be judgment. Believe me, child of God, God is going to judge evil. And when that day comes, there is no evildoer, irrespective of your gender or your name or your position, that will escape it. Child of God, I know things are tough, but tough times are opportunity for great people to shine the best. I know there are pressures all around you, but see, God is more than able to stand up for you and through you in the face of that pressure. Dare to be different. Because you are different, because God trusts you, and because there surely is going to be a punishment. Let hands be joined with hands. The sinner will definitely not escape punishment. I want to thank God that you have listened to me. And I believe God that on the strength of this exaltation, he has given you a very strong reason to look inward. Because inside of you is the power of God, which is the Holy Spirit. And within, there is no mountain of trial that you cannot climb. There is no river of temptation that you cannot swim through. God is on your side, child of God. Hold on. He will come through for you. Remember again, the Bible said, but Noah was different in his generation. And that which made him to be different, the Bible said, God liked it. May the Lord see it in you. Commitment, faithfulness, determination, and righteousness. May the Lord see in you that which will make him to help you. Because at the end of the day, you remember, God came through for Noah. He eventually was the only one that survived. Everybody. The strength they ran for and ran after failed them, they all died. God is faithful, child of God. He will see you through. Again, until I see you next Wednesday, I'm believing God that you will live under the atmosphere of grace, and whatever temptation is upon you, you will overcome. God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray. I pray for you that is listening to me, whatever pressure you are under, receive grace to hold on to God in the days of this pressure. And I pray that the Lord will come through for you and turn this pressure to precious reward in the name of Jesus Christ. If you are yet to be born again, I pray for you that the Lord will appear to you, convict you of sin, and help you to give your life to Christ. And may the benefit of a saved life begin to accrue to you from today. In Jesus' name, I pray for you. Amen. Thank you.